there's a whole new way of assigning addresses to devices with IPv6. Of course, we can still do this manually, and we can still use DHCP, but now we have new options, including EUI64 and Slaac. Working with IPv6 addresses really isn't that hard. Here we have a network card on a Windows workstation. See how there's a TCP/IP stack for IPv4 and IPv6? That's dual stack. The IPv6 settings look familiar, but it's still a bit different. We can still use DHCP, or one of the fascinating new technologies to get an IP automatically. Or we can configure it statically. But this is a CCNA series, so we'll spend most of our time on a router. Many of the commands we're familiar with still work. We just use IPv6 instead of IP. For example, show IPv6 interface brief. We have no IP addresses so far. Now to configure a global unicast address. Under the interface, we just use the IPv6 address command. It's almost the same as IPv4, except we use CIDR notation for the prefix length, not a dotted decimal subnet mask. Looking at our interface list again, we can see two new IP addresses. One is the global unicast address that we just configured. Of course, we can use this to ping other addresses. There is also a link local address. This is created automatically when IPv6 is enabled on an interface. Notice when we ping, it asks for the output interface. Do you know why? Link local IPs are fully functional, with the exception of being non-routable. Because of this, all link local IPs are in the same subnet, that is, Fffe80/64. So the router needs to know which interface to use for the ping. One final trick is statically mapping an IP to a host name. This is done with the IPv6 host command, followed by the name and IP. Remember, all these commands are in the study notes. A quick ping confirms the name is mapping to the IP correctly. Let's take a step back and think about link local addresses again. We don't usually configure them, they're automatically generated. This uses a system called EUI64. The idea behind EUI64 is that you supply the prefix and the host portion of the IP is automatically generated. In the case of link local addresses, the prefix is always Fffe80. The question is, how is the host portion generated without causing IP conflicts with other devices? Well, your network card already has a unique address. It's MAC address. Follow along with me here. Open a command prompt and find your MAC address. Now, write that MAC address down. The MAC address is 48 bits long and is made up of two parts. The first half is the OUI, which is the manufacturer's ID. The second half is the NIC ID. The host portion of the link local address is 64 bits long, so the MAC needs to be extended. The hex number FFFE is added right in the middle of the MAC address. Next, the weirdest thing happens. The seventh bit is flipped. To do this, find the value of the seventh bit. If it's a 0, change it to a 1. If it's a 1, change it to a 0. Why is this done? Because this bit has a special meaning within MAC addresses. Once we add the prefix to this host ID, we have the full IP address. This is known as a modified EUI64 address. So that's the official way to generate a link local address. Some operating systems, like Windows, have their own way of generating addresses. Why? I don't know. They just want to be different, I guess. EUI can be used for other addresses as well, and the same principles apply. Under the interface, we give the router a prefix and give it the EUI64 keyword. Let's take a look at the interfaces again. And we can see the new IP addresses here. It's easy to tell it's an EUI64 address because of the FFFE in the address. Notice that this doesn't override the other IP addresses we've configured. It just adds a new one. The two quiz questions here are, well, interesting, but they're also quite tricky. Let's call these ones optional. There are more ways to have addresses dynamically assigned, but first we need to know about the Neighbour Discovery Protocol, or NDP. NDP is a collection of tools that are critical to IPv6 operating correctly. It resolves IP addresses to MAC addresses. In IPv4, this was done by ARP, the Address Resolution Protocol. In IPv6, that's NDP's job. It discovers IPv6 routers and other devices in the local network. This is useful if a client is trying to find a default gateway. It can automatically discover network prefixes. This is clearly useful for assigning IP addresses to clients, and we'll talk about that soon. And it includes a tool called duplicate address detection. This checks if there are any IP conflicts when assigning a new address. At the core of NDP is ICMP version 6. ICMP is the protocol that sends messages between devices. This includes ping and often traceroute. There are four ICMP messages that NDP uses, as we'll soon see. The router has information that the client needs. This could be something like IP address information, prefix length, and things like these. The client can use NDP to ask the router for this information. It does this by sending a neighbor solicitation message from its link local address to all IPv6 routers on the link. There are no broadcasts anymore, so it uses the All Routers multicast group. If a router has the requested information, it replies with a router advertisement message. This message contains the information that the client wants. Before continuing, a brief word on multicast. All IPv6 multicast groups start with FF. If you see any of these starting with FF02, that's because they're link local multicast groups. These addresses are for the local subnet only. Here are some of the common multicast groups that you might see. Of particular interest is the solicited-node multicast address. This one's a bit confusing, so let me take a moment to clear it up. Every time we configure a unicast address on an interface, the interface also joins a solicited-node multicast group. The IP of the group can vary, but it will always follow this format. It selects the last 24 bits of the address based on the unicast address on the interface. Our router is using this unicast address. Let's expand this out to make things easier. A router takes the last 24 bits of the unicast address and uses them as the last 24 bits of the solicited node multicast address. Let's see that on a router. First, let's configure the unicast address. We'll now use Show IPv6 Interface to look at the interface in detail. As you can see, there's a link local address and a global unicast address. We can also see that this interface has joined a few multicast groups. Notice that there's a corresponding group for each unicast address. The big question is, what are these groups used for? For that, we need to think about how IPv6 devices are discovered on the network. In particular, how IPv6 addresses are mapped to MAC addresses. In IPv4, this is done with ARP, the Address Resolution Protocol. This doesn't work in IPv6 as ARP relies on broadcasts. Instead, the process is like this. A device wants to send a message to another device. It needs to know the MAC address to do this. So the first thing it will do is it will look in its neighbor cache to see if it has previously learned the MAC. If it's not there, it needs to learn it. NDP sends a neighbor solicitation message to ask who owns that IP address. But this isn't a broadcast. NS messages are sent to the solicited node multicast address. The sending device already knows the IP address, so it can easily take the last 24 bits of the IP address and use them to work out what the solicited node multicast address is. Imagine if there were 200 workstations on the network. IPv4 would broadcast to all of them. IPv6 multicasts to one or a few. Much better. The device receives the neighbor solicitation message and responds with a neighbor advertisement message. This time it's a unicast message. The NA message includes the device's MAC address. The original requester can now update the neighbor cache. Detecting duplicate addresses, that is IP conflicts, is a slight variation of this neighbor discovery process. When an IP is auto-configured, it will send a neighbor solicitation message to the solicited node multicast address for that IP. If some device is already using that IP, it will see this message and it will reply. If there is no reply, then the address is still available for use. Now that we have a good understanding of NDP, we can start thinking about how devices can obtain their IP addresses automatically. We can now get into some truly dynamic IP configuration. There are a couple of options available to us. The first one is called Slaac, or Stateless Address Auto-Configuration. So what does stateless mean? That's an easy one to answer. stateless just means that nothing will keep track of the IP addresses that have been assigned. This is in contrast to DHCP, which keeps a database of assigned IPs. Slaac is stateless, so it doesn't care which IPs are in use and which aren't. It might sound weird, but as you'll soon see, this isn't a problem at all. When a client needs an IP address, it will use NDP to request one. It will send a router solicitation message to the All IPv6 Routers group from its link local address. The client is really asking which prefix is in use on the local link. A router will respond with the router advertisement message. This is sent from its link local address to the All IPv6 Nodes multicast group. In this message, it sends the prefix and the length for this link. It does not allocate the host portion of the IP. The client generates this itself using EUI64. This is why Slaac can be stateless. With each device generating its own IP, there's no need to track anything. The client then combines the prefix with the host portion to get a full IP. It then confirms its uniqueness using duplicate address detection. Configuring Slaac on a router is not hard at all. We're going to configure R1 to hand out prefixes. We'll then configure R2 to be a Slaac client. Step 1 is to enable IPv6 unicast routing. Certain IPv6 functions won't work without this being enabled first. As soon as we configure the router with a global unicast IP, it will start sending router advertisement messages. In the RA messages, it includes the prefix from the interface. Over on our client router, we just configure the interface to receive an IP address automatically. This is the IPv6 address autoconfig command. Looking at the interfaces, we can see that this one has an automatically configured IP. Notice that the second half looks similar to a link local address? That's the EUI64 process. So Slaac is enabled automatically when we have a global IP configured. What if we don't want that? We can suppress all RA messages from the router with IPv6 NDRA suppress. This isn't just Slaac though, so use it with caution. Well, that's nice and easy, right? Well, there's a problem. Can you see what it is? Slaac doesn't give the client any extra information. What about the DNS servers, for example? The client needs to know about those as well. For this reason, Slaac hasn't been widely adopted. If we want to pass extra information to the router, we need to use another option, such as DHCP. DHCP v6 can be stateful, where leases are tracked, or stateless. Stateless DHCP is a new concept for IPv6, as it combines traditional DHCP with Slaac. The idea behind this is that a client IP is generated with Slaac, and then the DHCP server assigns the rest of the options. DNS server IPs, domain names, and that sort of thing. NDP is still used with stateful DHCP. The client requests an IP from the router, and the router tells the client about a DHCP server. It's probably easier to see it in action. We'll now configure R1 as a stateful DHCP server. R2 will be the client. We must enable IPv6 unicast routing before starting. Then we can create a pool. I've named this one Test Stateful. Next, the IPv6 prefix that will be handed out to the clients. And then any other options. I'm just going to add a DNS server and a domain name. We need to configure the interface too, starting with an IP. The IP DHCP server command tells the router which pool we want to use on this interface. We then enable the managed config flag in NDP. This tells the client that this will be stateful DHCP, not Slaac. Now let's configure the client R2. We need to enable IPv6 routing globally. And then we need to enable IPv6 on the interface. Then it's just a matter of configuring the interface with DHCP. Looking at the interfaces, we can confirm this has worked. Sorry, the command is interface, not interfaces. Let's try that again, but this time we'll use stateless config. In the background of this video, I have already removed the previous config from these routers. As before, we need IPv6 routing enabled and a DHCP pool. This is only DHCP options this time. We don't need a prefix as this is delivered through Slaac. Under the interface, we configure an IP address as normal. Then we add the pool configuration. And finally, we enable the other config flag. Sorry, just let me fix that typo. This tells the client to get its IP through Slaac, but to use DHCP for other options. We configure R2, our client, the same way we do for Slaac. The last thing to do is confirm that it has worked. And there it is. To summarize, stateful DHCP is the traditional type of DHCP that hands out IPs and other options and tracks leases. Stateless DHCP uses Slaac to assign an IP address and the DHCP server to assign options. In today's lab, we have 5 routers. R1 is to provide IP addresses to the other 4. Your job is to configure this as shown, as well as troubleshoot why R5 is not working. The configuration is not over. We've got one more IPv6 video in the series, and this one is about routing. That includes static IP routing and OSPF version 3. I hope to see you there.